beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Early Christians had a fundamental understanding that Jesus was God. God became man so that we might have a chance to dwell with God and have eternity with God. What are ways that we can do as a Maranatha community to practice service and humility?
Glory and honor, dominion and power.
Quip that young adults are an endangered species. We're living in perilous times. Generation Y, the millennials, these are the leaders of today. They are also the leaders of the future. So we treasure young adults at Maranatha. I want to thank the elders because over the past few years, they have had an elder in charge of our millennials, in charge of our young adults and our youth. And I thank Elder Mabuti Ngandu, who has had the vision and the foresight to try to work with young people. Today, I am excited to introduce to you our very own pastor for youth and young adults, and that is Nathan Wiggins. He's a child of Maranatha, grew up at Maranatha, matured at Maranatha. He was born and bred at Maranatha. He was buttered at Maranatha, if you like. I want to thank God for Nathan. He has come a long way. I have enjoyed working with him the past few years, just sharing the pulpit with him. He is truly a gentleman and a scholar, a theologian in his own right. And I thank God that God has seen him through his first degree, and he's already working on his master's degree. And I'm honored to have Nathan as a partner in ministry as he leads out in youth and young adult ministry. God has gifted Nathan. He comes from a long line of preachers. His grandfather, the Reverend Dr. Ernest Newborn, was a preacher. And his grandmother, the Reverend Dr. Janice Robinson Newborn, is also in the history books as a great preacher. His cousin, Pastor Baron Savory, his great uncle, Pastor Evangelist Alan Savory. Nathan comes from a long line of ministry leaders, and I'm grateful for the leadership of his father, Elder Don Wiggins, who is one of our elders here in charge of our building and infrastructure. And I'm grateful also for the ministry of Nathan's mother, Dr. Mary Jo Wiggins, who serves in finance ministry as well as in education ministry. I'm grateful for Meredith, who is an upcoming psalmist and the sister to Nathan Wiggins. This is a family that loves to serve. I'm just grateful that Nathan can pick up this mantle to work with all of our youth and our young adults. Hear ye him. And before you get to hear him, we will be favored with the special music of Nicole Ford, after which the next voice that we will hear is that of our pastor for youth and young adults, Nathan Wiggins. Hear ye them.
Morning, church. It is good to be back. It has been over 2 years since I had an opportunity to preach, and I just want to thank Pastor Mufawa for giving me this opportunity. Thank the elders for giving me this opportunity, and I certainly did not believe that it was, you know, at the time it was going to be in this capacity and this medium. But those are the times that we are living in, and I pray that everyone in the Maranatha community is staying safe, staying healthy, and staying positive in these very trying times. And with that in mind, let's pray and invite the Lord into this space, into this virtual space. So, dear Jesus, we just invite you to be a part of our community, and we invite your presence to be a part of this virtual space, Lord, and just want to thank you for all of the blessings that you give each and every one of us every day, another day of life, another day to create, another day to learn, and another day to grow, Lord. And we just cannot thank you enough for the ultimate sacrifice that you paid for each and every one of us, Lord. With that in mind, I just pray that you will give me the strength and the guidance, and that it will not be my will that's done, or my words, but it is your will and your words, Lord. In your name we pray. Amen. So, all right, here we go. So, turn with me, if you can, to Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 to 9. I'll repeat that. Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 to 9. And this is what it says. Have this in mind amongst yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself, taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, And being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient even to the point of death on a cross. So, although this passage is found in the letter to the Philippians, we need to understand the history of it before we can dissect it. So it is believed by scholars that this passage actually predates the Pauline letter to the Philippians. And knowing this can give us an understanding of what the early Christians believed about Jesus even before the Gospels were written or before the letters of Paul. Now, Christianity is monotheistic. That's not a surprise to anybody, and I hope we can all agree that it is. And coming out of the Jewish tradition, we believe in only one God. You guys don't need to tell me. You guys don't need me to tell you this. However, Christianity has this interesting almost paradox to it of God as Trinity, Trinitarian theology. And it has confused non-Christians ever since the split of Christianity and Judaism in the first century CE. But we look at a passage like this, and it really gives us a clue into what early Christians understood about Jesus. And this term is called the preexistence of Christ, the preexistence of the second in the Trinity. And this theology is further developed in the Gospels, and I think no better than John chapter 1, verses 1, the prologue to John. So if you can turn with me to John chapter 1, verse 1. And it says, we've heard it all before, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Now, when we look at the term Word in this sense, in the beginning was the Word, we need to understand what the original Greek is. And when we translate Word back to its original Greek, we find that the term is Logos, L-O-G-O-S. But Logos means so much more than just word. It has a whole host of meanings, such as knowledge, wisdom, understanding. And this was a common term in early Greek philosophy, the Logos. It was the essence of everything, the essence of understanding. That's what the Logos was. And so the author of John's Gospel connects the Logos to God the Son, the second in the Trinity, who became incarnate on earth in the person of Jesus of Nazareth. But this passage in Philippians tells us that, wait a second, this understanding of the preexistence of Christ, the divine nature of Christ, goes back so much earlier than John's Gospel, which was written approximately in the year 90 AD. There were plenty of early Christian controversies about the divine nature of Jesus and how one could explain that Jesus was both fully human and fully divine. And one that I want to talk about for a brief second, because it's so essential to understanding understanding early Christian history, is the Arian controversy. And I don't mean Arian as in blonde-haired, blue-eyed, and racist. I mean Arian coming from the second century presbyter Arius. So Arius was a North African church leader who sought to explain the Trinity. And he came to the conclusion that the Son was not equal to God the Father, but instead a creation of God the Father, thus making the Son less than God the Father. And this specific teaching is called subordinationism. And Arius said himself, there was a time that the Son was not, meaning that he denied the pre-existing nature of Christ, that there was God the Father, and then God the Father created God the Son. So this teaching was justified in a few ways, the first of which being that throughout the Gospels, we see Jesus praying to the Father. He says that, I can do nothing without the Father. And these passages became evidence to Arius that the Son was less than God the Father, and so must have been created by God the Father. And this teaching, it made sense to people because it understood something that they struggled to understand. It helped to understand the Trinity. Now, it became so popular in so many Christian communities that in the year 325, the first ecumenical council of Nicaea was called by Emperor Constantine to refute the heresy of Arianism. And this was not the only heresy that grew popular as an attempt to explain the Trinity. There was also the heresy of adoptionism. And adoptionism is exactly what it sounds like. That God the Father adopted Jesus as his adopted son. But this passage that we read about in Philippians shows us the errors with both Arianism and adoptionism. Because it says that Jesus was in the form of God and uses the phrase equality with God. Now, as I stated earlier, this passage is called a Christological hymn, and it predates the Pauline letter. It may have been written as early as the 40s Common Era. And what this means is that early Christians had a fundamental understanding that Jesus was God, that he had an equality with God, that he was not a lesser God, or he wasn't a creation of the Father, but that he himself was God, that he was the second in the Trinity. But this understanding of a pre-existence is something that is even seen in the Old Testament, and I'll show you where. And turn with me to Proverbs chapter 8, verses 22. Once again, that's Proverbs chapter 8, verse 22. I'll go ahead and read it. The Lord possessed me at the beginning of his work, the first of his acts of old. Ages ago, I was set up at the first, before the beginning of earth. When there were no depths, I was brought forth. When there were no springs abounding with water. Before the mountains had been shaped, before the hills, I was brought forth. Before he had made the earth with its fields, or the first dust of the world. When he established the heavens, I was there. When he drew a circle in the face of the deep, when he made firm the skies above, when he established the fountains of the deep, when he assigned the sea its limit, so that the waters might not transgress his command. When he marked out the foundations of the earth, I was beside him, like a master workman. I was daily his delight, rejoicing before him always, rejoicing in his inhabited world and delighting in the children of men. Now, who is this mystery speaker? Who is this that is talking about that they were with God at the point of creation? This mystery speaker is wisdom. And now think back to the definitions of logos. What was one of the definitions of logos? It was wisdom. And so now here we see the connection between the wisdom of the Old Testament, like the personification of wisdom, I should say, personification of wisdom in the Old Testament, and the personification of the Logos in the New Testament. And both of those are represented by the second in the Trinity, God the Son. Quick note here, I think it is very interesting that throughout the Old Testament, wisdom is personified as female. So we have a very interesting, interesting little concept here at play, that one of the times in the Bible where wisdom and a deity is personified as female. Just a quick little note for y'all. Now, I'm sure you're wondering, is this guy just going to sit here and give us a history lesson, or is he planning on actually making a point? And I promise you, we are going to transition to that right now, because let's look at the rest of the passage. Now, the hymn says that he, meaning Jesus, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped at. Let's think about that, something to be grasped at. This presents us with an interesting juxtaposition between Christ and Adam. And this was something that Paul was really big into. He was really big into Jesus as a new Adam. And I believe that that is particularly why Paul may have wanted to incorporate this hymn into his letter to the Philippians, because Paul loved Christ as the new Adam theology. And we can see this in his letter to the Romans. So you can turn with me to Romans chapter 5, verse 15. Give me a second to turn to that. That is Romans chapter 5, verse 15. But the free gift is not like the trespass. For many died through one man's trespass, much more have the grace of God and the free gift of grace through one man, that is Jesus Christ, abounded for many. That one man, Jesus Christ, abounded for many. And that free gift is not the result of one man's sin. For the judgment following one's trespass brought condemnation, but the free gift following many trespasses brought justification. For it, because of one man's trespass, death reigned through that one man, much more who will receive the abundance of grace and the free gift of righteousness reign in life through one man, Jesus Christ. Therefore, trespass led to condemnation for all men. Therefore, as one trespass led to condemnation for all men, so one act of righteousness leads to justification and life for all men. For as by one man's obedience there were many sinners, so by the one man's obedience the many will be made righteous. Now the law came in to increase the trespass, but where sin increased, grace abounded all the more, so that sin reigned in death, grace also might reign through the righteousness leading to eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Now, right here, Paul is saying that because of the actions of Jesus, we are saved in spite of the actions of Adam. See, Adam sought equality with God. He reached out and tried to grasp equality with God. But Jesus, instead of grasping for equality, humbled himself and became a man, became a human being through the incarnation. And humility, I believe, is the key part of this passage, of this Christological hymn, because humility is one of the five characteristics of the kingdom of God. And we as Christians are called to be members of the kingdom of God. We are called to be humble and we are called to serve. Now turn with me to Mark chapter 10, verses 42 to 45. That's Mark chapter 10, verses 42 to 45. Jesus, talking to his disciples, says, "You know those who are regarded as rulers of the Gentiles, lorded over them, and their high officials exercise authority over them. Not so with you. Not so with you. Instead, whoever wants to become great amongst you must become your servant, and whoever wants to be first must become slave of all. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and give his life as a ransom for many." Now, Adam lacked humility. He wanted to become equal to God. Jesus, although he was already equal to God, humbled himself through the incarnation. And because of that, because God became a human being, we now have the chance to become one with God ourselves. Because we understand that Jesus was both 100% human and 100% divine. Now, as I wrap this up, I felt like it was only appropriate, since I began this message talking about early Christian history, I felt like it was only appropriate to wrap it up with a couple of quotes from two early church fathers who set the foundations of Christianity in the hundreds of years following the death of the apostles. The first comes from Athanasius the Great, who said, "God became man so that we might become gods, that we might have a chance to dwell with God and have eternity with God, and that we might have the chance to become members of the kingdom of God." The second quote comes from Gregory of Nazianzus, or Gregory the theologian, either one, who said, "What has not been assumed has not been healed." Repeat that one more time. What has not been assumed has not been healed. And what that means is that because God became a human being through the incarnation, that the sinful nature of us as human beings has been healed. See, if God had not become a human being, there would have been no opportunity to save humanity. Do you guys see what I'm saying? What has not been assumed has not been healed. So, what does this have to do with us? What does this have to do with us? Well, I want to offer everyone a challenge. Each day, we all have opportunities to have humility. We all have opportunities to serve, whether it's with our friends, with our family, at our job. And so I offer this to you as a challenge, something to think about, but not only something to think about, but something to be about. What are ways that you as an individual can practice humility and service in your life? And now, think about it more broadly. What are ways that we can do as a Maranatha community to practice service and humility? We are living in crazy times right now with the pandemic and the acts of police brutality and state-sanctioned violence that are happening even in our own community. So my question to you is, how can we as individuals and how can we as a community come together and practice humility, service, and have that same humility that Jesus had, going from being equal to God to becoming a human through the incarnation. Thank you very much, church. Thank you once again to Pastor Mubaba and the elders for giving me the wonderful opportunity to speak. And I hope everyone has a happy Sabbath.
Sweeter than the honey.